behalf of the family of Landis and Eisenstein, we are grateful that you have come together and to share with us the grieving of our sister Evelyn. Thank you for taking the time and to celebrate your life with us this afternoon. Shall we all start the service by singing hymn number 181? Shall we all stand? Does Jesus care?
Friends and family of Evelyn. her here because we love her and miss her. And we want to cherish our memories of her. We want to honor her life and honor her and support one another as we grieve her passing, a passing from life here with us to that everlasting life you promised for us. God, thank you for Evelyn. You formed her. You knew her. You walked with her through 51 years. And even now, we have confidence that we shall meet her again in that grand resurrection morning. Thank you that you are a God of mercy who promises to comfort us, particularly when we lose our loved ones. And so in these moments now, and in the weeks and months ahead, please bring comfort and mercy to us as we remember and share fondly all that Evelyn was to us. In the mighty and holy name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
People fondly call me Toby for short. I am the last, the youngest among the 10 children, and Evelyn is the number 9. So I was after her. Evelyn Blandes was born to Francisco and Rita Blandes on January 16, 1964, in Balogo, Pincawayan, Cotabato City, Mindanao, Philippines, the second to the youngest 10 of children. Evelyn started her schooling in 1972 at Camos SDA Elementary School in Davao City, Philippines. At an early age, she took interest in music, especially playing the piano and singing in the church choir. Evelyn graduated elementary at Camos SDA Elementary School in Davao City, Philippines in 1976 and advanced her high school education at Southern Mindanao Academy and graduated in 1980. She excelled at school with honors in elementary and high school. Evelyn showed a desire to pursue a degree in medicine and started her studies of pre-med at Philippine Union College, Silang Cavite, Philippines. Evelyn received her diploma from the School of Dancing at Tacloban Medical School and took her residency at the Manila Sanitarium and Hospital in Pasay City, Manila, Philippines. Evelyn then migrated to Canada in 1992, where she spent time working at an elderly boarding home owned by a Filipino family. She joined the Surrey Seventh-day Adventist Church and was often at the piano and in the choir. She enjoyed her stay in Canada because she was a part of a large Filipino group and many she knew from her college days at PUC or Philippine Union College, now at Venice University of the Philippines. After a concert performed by a mutual friend from the Philippines, Evelyn would meet her future husband. After the concert, Evelyn decided to spend a night at her best friend Grace Gamponia's apartment. Grace's brother Julius, who happened to be best friends with Ernest Eisenstein, was coming over, and also because they came from Seattle to watch the concert and needed a place to sleep, where they met Evelyn for the first time. Little did Ernest and Evelyn know that they would be married 6 months later. Ernest started calling Evelyn from Seattle and visiting on the weekends. Evelyn and Ernest had many things in common, like playing musical instruments, Bible subjects, and the design of dialect. After 3 months of courtship, Evelyn and Ernest decided that the Lord was putting their relationship together, and it was obvious that it would lead to marriage. Ernest and Evelyn settled in Washington State, where they raised two boys, Earl and Eric. Ernest and Evelyn owned a few elderly homes where Evelyn became the RN or registered nurse. Evelyn also worked outside the home in hospitals. Ernest and Evelyn relocated to Tappahannock, Virginia in 2008 and moved to California in 2014, where Evelyn was training to be a medical missionary doctor to the Philippines, which was her dream. In September of 2014, Ernest left for the Philippines to prepare the way for his and Evelyn's move. The clinic was offered to Evelyn, where she could practice her medicine and missionary work. In May of 2015, Evelyn went to the Philippines to spend some time with Ernest. Evelyn knew something was physically wrong, and in November 2015, she started having back pains and abdominal pains. Evelyn was diagnosed with endometrial carcinoma on the 24th of November and passed on to her rest on the 20th of December 2015. It is so sad that Evelyn's life ended so early in such a tragic way. It is hard to accept that she will no longer be with us. She had a loving family and friends and a brilliant career. No one was prepared for this tragedy. It can be difficult to understand how life works sometimes. Thanks always in knowing that Evelyn is now sleeping, awaiting the return of her maker. Her memory will live in our hearts forever. We will all be happy of her accomplishments forever, and we'll never forget how wonderful a person she was. Thank you everyone for coming, and God bless.
My part is to give tribute to Evelyn. Right after I heard that she had passed away, I offered a prayer and I said, "Thank you, God, for giving Evelyn to us, not just to me, but to the church." Because immediately a year and a half ago, she came to our church and sat in the back part. And suddenly, me and my Aunt Nina just gravitated to her and talked to her. And we found her as a very gentle, soft-spoken person. And yet it was so swift and brief, sweet time with Evelyn. And in the later part of her life, she was my confidant, and she did make a difference in my life. Again, life's journey is about making success, and that you have made a difference in somebody's life. And with that, Evelyn would always text me and give me comfort about text, special texts that she likes. But also, with the past year and a half, she would come to my house and she would talk about the Bible. And my tribute to this lady is that she was, if there's one word I want to describe her, a devoted friend. And she was very caring. She would text me, and sometimes she'd be worried about something. And also she would help me with a program. But indeed, she was a special gift to Apple Valley Church because she had that gift of music where we needed her so badly. And then I did ask God, "Why, God, have you taken Evelyn so soon when you know that we needed her?" But then again, God in his own way knows and does provide. But however, she is a lady of devoted mother. She cried in her children, Earl and Eric. She would talk about, and her hopes about you to me, because she was my confidant in the last part of her life. And likewise, her dream of going back to the Philippines. She's a devoted wife who knew her responsibility, likewise, as they were transitioning and their financial need, and also their transitioning and going to the Philippines. Likewise, she was a devoted Christian who wanted to be involved in a church. And all I know is that she was a gentle spirit who wanted to make a difference in the church. And she said, "Starting, I believe that music is a very important part in our service." And so she made a commitment because she wanted to go home to the Philippines right away. And I says, "No, not yet. You gotta stay, okay?" And she says, "Okay, I'll think it over." But then I think Ernest was also preparing a place for her. But the week before Thanksgiving, she came to my house. We ate together, my aunt and I. We enjoyed the fish stew that I made. And she said, "Starling, I am in pain. My back hurts so bad." And I said, "You need to have a doctor see you." And she was very conservative about health, and I knew that she refrained from x-rays and all that. But after our Thanksgiving meeting at the church, she came to me and she said, "Starling, I don't want to go home. I want to go to your house, and let's sing together." I said, "Fine, be at my house. We're going to have Thanksgiving early dinner, and we're going to sing." And I know she was already in pain, but she tried so hard, and she gave all her voice and her talent, and we would sing our trio together, and we enjoyed. enjoyed, and I tell you, it was precious moments when we did that. And yesterday morning, before going to church, I picked up the song from that she loved so much. And I said, God, thank you for Evelyn, in spite of the fact that she has left us so soon. Celebration of life is now making me say that Evelyn indeed had left an indomitable imprint in my heart. And she might have left us physically, Earl, Ernest, and Eric. She may not be with us physically, but keep her close to your heart. And she will ever, forever be with us and has made a difference in our life. So, this afternoon, I praise God for Evelyn. I praise for the talent that she had made a difference in our lives and in our church. Thank you.
With your permission, I will just stay here because in my 49 years of ministry, I love many aspects of my ministry, the Lord's ministry. But one thing I'm going to like is when I am asked to do funeral service. Because personally, my father died suddenly in the Supreme Hospital of a heart attack. It was so sudden that in my young years of ministry, I asked the Lord why he took away my father. From that time on, I inhibited myself to do funeral service. So when we visited Evelyn some 3 weeks ago in Vermont, Ernest asked me if I would do the homily. If it were not for two things, I would say no, because I know that Pastor Elder Morali is the head pastor of their church, and also Pastor Escamas is the associate. But Ernest is my nephew. We are related. Second, in 1993, Pastor Tiga brought me to Seattle to establish the first Filipino-American church. There are 5 conferences in Northwest Pacific Union Conference, but there was no Filipino-American church. Most of the Filipinos were worshiping in Anglo-American church. So I was there, and there were 13 of them. I thought Ernest was a blue-blooded German-American because the father is a German. So I tried myself to talk in my Visayan accent English, as he was responding me in his good English. But after some time, we were in the house of Mr. and Mrs. Beteta. He was asking for Inon Onan in Pakse. I realized that he was really a blue-blooded Cebuano. And when we traced our lineage, his mother is a Teres from Osama City. And when we traced, I have now a German Filipino nephew. Second thing is, we needed a pianist in our new church. We were only 30, but they were good singers. And I was asking him, could you find somebody in Canada? A nurse? Whoever it is, as long as he plays the piano. We did. It is for a selfish market. The Lord provided a miracle that happened, as mentioned by the brother. And it was my privilege to solemnize the wedding some 21 years ago. It is my privilege right now, even if I am hesitant to do the homily, because of these reasons, I do this because I love Ernest and I love you. From 13 members today, we have bought a church for $500,000 cash. And today, we are worshiping with 280 members this year. The first Filipino American church. You are a part of that, and this wonderful lady is a part of the practice of course. God has given us Ernest and Evelyn. So to you, Ernest, thank you so much. And these little boys were running around our church. But I hope that someday you become a pastor to take my place. And to you, whatever you are, God bless you. Have you been stung by a bee? How did you have this family? How did you feel? Some many years ago, I was invited in a pristine falls in Leyte, in Onaga Leyte. 500 young people, but I love young people. I want to be young like them. I was their youth director, so I was with them for a week. The last part, it was Sabbath, 11 o'clock. I was about 27 years old, full of vigor and life. I was bombastic in my sermon. Suddenly there was a swarm of bees, and everybody ran for their lives. Pastor, run! I could have run. But the swarm of bees was after me. Perhaps the commander did not like my sermon. So they sent some special forces to attack me. I was stunned. My eyes had become blurry. My face becomes tightened. My breath was a little bit, I was gasping. And then it was almost no time, but it seems to be moonlit night. I tried to call for help, but there was no voice. And I said, I am going to die because I heard that if you're allergic to this thing, you might die. And then Onaga is about 25 kilometers. There was no jeep or people that would bring me to Onaga. Pristine waterfalls up in the mountain. I could remember that I just said, Lord, please help me. This thing, and Paul said, O death, where is O grave thy victory? Paul, he already knew that he was being beheaded in Rome. So he wrote to the Corinthians, or Romans said, O death, what is your sting? Because death, like this thing, hurts. Painful and paralyzed. Your vision for the future is blurry. And you know that without and outside God, you will perish. Why do we die, my friends? Is it God's plan that I should die? You will die. And if you die on this little man here, and this, my grandsons will cry, and I cry. Is it God's plan? The reason why you die, because someone believed in a snake. And the snake told a lie, and that woman told the husband about the snake's lie, and both of them believed in the snake's lie. And we inherited the result of the lie that the snake was giving. You know that, you're 7 days dead. So what happened? We died. As Paul was saying, it says, as one man sinned, death comes. All have sinned and have come short of the glory of God, therefore everyone dies. Now I have a little thing that I will share with you. December 2015, 56 million people died around the world from all causes. 56 million died last year. Doing a quick math, that means approximately 153,425 died every day. Or 106 people die every minute. Before I would finish my sermon or homily, many already died. I was burying somebody in Bimbis Island, Seattle. I was bringing my 5-year-old grandson. I said, hey, Jim, stay there. No. And there were many people. As we lowered the casket of this gentleman from Bainbridge Island, AJ was walking down there. And when everybody was done, he said, who's next? For a big audible of a 5-year-old, who's next? Everybody turned up. They were not laughing. Because this was asked by a 5-year-old boy. Looking at the casket was asking, who's next? May I ask you, who's next after everything? It could be me, it could be you. Life is uncertain. Would you believe that? But I am glad that God has promised us something. Something beautiful, because as one man said, Jesus Christ came, became like you and me, died, sinless. And then he said, I am the resurrection of life. If you believe in me, even if you die, you will live eternally. Not physically, of course, but eternally. And what is the promise in John 3:16? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have what? An ending, everlasting life. What a promise, my friends. What a promise. I was there that fateful Saturday after a potluck in the Apollonic Church. Pastor Stamos, and Pastor Pemis, you have some other programs. Please, let's go to Evelyn's home. Because Ernest is waiting for us. Evelyn's life might be ended today. So what do we have? For the first time in my life, I saw somebody gasping for breath. Evelyn was dying. Ernest was only uncle. Evelyn, but he gradually died after 2 hours. What? After 2 hours? And I could see Evelyn, like gasping. I said, Lord, please. In my mind, please, Lord, extend his life. You have extended his life, Ezekiel's life, for 15 years. And somehow from there, we went to the hospital and I prayed with people of our church, Brother Adams, and I said, Lord, extend his life for 15 years. Honor or plead, petition, please. But I will be done. And so, in that last moment, we have to go. I asked Ernest to please stand. And so Ernest will please stand, right? And you are a candidate with this man. James is coming. So next, I told him I saw your wedding 21 years ago. I asked Ernest to hold the hand of Evelyn. As Ernest held the hand of Evelyn, memories flooded my mind and my heart 21 years ago when I asked Ernest, would you promise before the Lord, before this congregation, that you will love, honor, respect, and love Evelyn till death do you part? And Ernest said, yes, Pastor, I do. And when I held their hands together, I asked Evelyn, would you promise to love and honor Ernest, disregarding others, and love him for better or for worse in sickness or in health? And Evelyn said, yes, I do. Ernest, do you remember that? Do you remember that? Evelyn cannot hear us, but I will say this to you. Ernest, would you promise to be faithful to the Lord? In spite of the struggles and challenges that you're going to have, as a lonely, quasi matter, it be that you promise before the Lord, before him, his family and friends, that you will be faithful to the Lord, so that when the Lord Jesus comes, he will be able to introduce you to you and say, Ernest, this is the Lord. You'll be a Christ here. Would you promise that? And so you earn everything. You, James, we're just still here as family. The Lord is looking at us now. God is also great because God has feelings. Would you promise also before the Lord? Together, we will be faithful to us. Come with me in your response. You know, we don't do some situations in your life because you say, Lord, why? But let us not question God, but we will just trust Him. That one of these days, you'll see your mother again. You will be faithful to Him. Would you promise it for them? Thank you for supporting James. You need it. Let us support one another. And with you, family and friends, let us promise before the Lord. All of us will promise to the Lord. Because one day, when the trumpet will sound, the Lord shall come, heavens will open. When the trumpet shall sound, the dead in Christ shall rise first. Amen. What a wonderful statement. Before I end, allow me to give this one. This is real fun. Is this alive or dead? If you is alive or dead. This is not artificial, this is new. But is this alive or dead? Audience, is this loss alive or dead? I don't want to own the answer because I was in a botany class when I was in high school and I was still alive. The question is, well, is this alive? If your answer is correct, I'll be demandified. If your answer is wrong, I'll be disidentified. Is this rose dead or alive? And I said alive, and I said disidentified. Dad of Mary, son of the principal, said, that is dead, we got disidentified. And he said, the answer is, this rose is neither dead nor alive, it is dying. You and I are like this rose. All of us are dying. Would you agree with me? According to Billy Graham, the moment a baby is born, there is an invisible line from the crib to the grave. Every day I step towards the grave. You and I is like this, we are dying. But thank the Lord, because when he comes, he said, I am the true vine. You are the branches attached to me, and you will live. Let us ask Jesus to be a part of our life and cling to him, even if we're dying. When he comes, we will have eternal life. Shall we recite John 14, 1 to 3? Again, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Receive you unto myself that where I am, your mother, my niece, your sister-in-law, your dear mother, and your wife will be with the Lord forevermore. This is my prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Dr. Evelyn Eisenstein was our student at the Institute of Integrative and Natural Health Sciences. She was with the first batch of graduates of the Missionary Natural Doctors Program, or MND program, in 2012. I remember that during the comprehensive final exams, she did so well. When she was tested, that she was made one of the examiners. I know that for a fact, because she was my classmate in that program. And we have here many of her classmates. May I ask her classmates to stand? Thank you. She had great plans for herself and her family in becoming a missionary natural doctor. She not only had an MND degree, but she also had, as you have heard, an MD degree. Along with her family, she planned on serving the Filipino people by setting up in the Philippines a practice that emphasizes the use of natural healing methods instead of conventional medicine. As part of her preparation in setting up her practice, she trained at the Integrative Healthcare Center under Dr. Jill Solomon and Dr. Ariel Garcia. She was an excellent healthcare provider, particularly in administering intravenous or IV nutrient delivery. I know that for a fact, because I was one of her patients. However, why we can improve the quality of life through natural health or even conventional medical means. The sad and inescapable fact remains that in the end, nobody, not even the best doctor, is exempt from the fangs of suffering and the destruction of man. the Institute of Integrative and Natural Health Sciences has lost a great talent and resource in Dr. Evelyn Eisenstein. We will immensely miss her.
Say this prayer full-heartedly, especially the one that says, God's will be done, as painful as it may be. We know that Atiyah will have left her mark on our lives, you know, and that she's left a legacy of love for all of us to remember. So, I invite you to just recite the words in your mind.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Is there a weird thing I'm feeling in my throat as I'm used to being all clear because I was in a touring in a choir in high school, so I'm used to having it all clear. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for coming. I just want to give special thanks on behalf of the Eisenstein and Plantis families. We would like to thank the Apple Valley All Nations Seventh-day Adventist Church for their warmth and hospitality, for bringing brothers and sisters to Evelyn and our family in the short time we were here. Your kindness to my mom was and always will be remembered in our hearts. To the Verduzco family, Adam, you went out of your way to help Evelyn when she needed help moving, and you are a big brother to her. You did not hesitate to do whatever was needed, and for this we are very grateful. And to Bibi, thanks for encouraging Evelyn to fight for life. She did not feel like there was any hope. To Starley, you were like a big sister to Evelyn. She enjoyed the talk and accompaniment you afforded her when she was here by herself, and also thanks for the counsel regarding her health. To Nana and Harold, Evelyn always enjoyed going to your home. You always had delicious Filipino food for her, and she also enjoyed the view outside your window. To Pastor and Mrs. Loyal Tevis, you officiated my mom and dad's wedding on May 15, 1994, in Seattle. You are a pastor that saw both Eric and I born and growing up. You were there with our family and by us through thick and thin, and now you're here to officiate my mom's celebration of life. May the Lord richly bless you. To Pastor Escamos, you were my mom's spiritual guide while she was here in Apple Valley
and she looked up to you as a man of faith. So Pastor Morality, Evelyn would see you at the Waterman Church and also the church here in Apple Valley. She always thought it was funny when you walked into church and heard beautiful piano music playing and you would say, "See Evelyn, Bala." And a special thanks to the NMD and supporters of the Alternative Clinic in Colton for your prayers and encouragement while Evelyn was with you. Auntie Jili, Baby Joy, Auntie Joy, Dr. Garcia, Auntie Daya, Doug, Evelyn Nguyen and Kenny, Joan Dell and Bernie, Tinelli, Ate Aida, and Kuya Norman. From Avan, Auntie Loida, Maria, Angelica, Auntie May, Gusto and Margie, Beverly, Ate Gina, and Kuya Ben. A special thanks to Annie. You were there almost every day while Evelyn was in the hospital singing, reading and rubbing her legs and arms with soothing lotions. When she was home in hospice, you were still there singing to her until her last night. God has given you a gift, and that gift will always be remembered by those who love you. Thanks. If there's anyone else whom we forgot to acknowledge, we want you to know that we thank you too. God has given you as a gift to our family, and we thank you all so much for your support and prayers. And personally, for me, I thank you all for coming and for supporting all the family and friends of my mom. I want to thank you too for coming and just supporting in your prayers, and whether you just offered a little prayer or came to stop by, I want to personally thank you. And it means a lot to me and especially to my brother and my dad. Thank you so much.
Let us rise and sing our closing song. Number 99.
Thank you.
feeling it right now. Thank you very much for that therapeutic effect of tears flowing from the eyes. We acknowledge your presence. And thank you very much for the life that you have, that you gave to Sister Evelyn. And to this end, we just would like to tell you that glory be unto your name, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory be to you from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen.
We will continue to celebrate the joy of our Sister Evelyn at the reception hall as we exit out. It's over to the left, to the right, over to the right. And you're all welcome to kind of share with us on behalf of the Apple Valley All Days Church. Come over and let's hang out and socialize and continue to be with the family. And also, for anyone or everyone that would like to come over and share the last moments before they remove the casket, please feel free to come forward and
Thank you.